Hello, everyone. My name is Ned Dennison. I'm the chairperson of the International Marathon Swimming Hall of Fame. We have a special guest with us today, Melanie Barrett. Will you say hello, Melanie?
Hello?
Melanie, give a brief introduction of yourself, if you could, please.
Well, I'm a swimmer, obviously. I used to swim in the pool. From a young age, I swam competitively and I competed for Great Britain in the Paralympics. I competed in World Championships, European Championships, and then in the Atlanta and Sydney Paralympics, which is obviously showing my age now. I got a gold and silver in Atlanta and a gold, silver and bronze in Sydney. And then I then went on to have a go at several different sports. I tried rowing and cycling, and then I ended up doing a triathlon. Enjoyed that a little bit. I went to the World Triathlon Championships, which I won in 2008, but unfortunately it wasn't a Paralympic sport at the time, so I retired from that a bit too early because it would have been great to go to London. But then I'd always really wanted to do open water swimming, but because I probably should have mentioned, I'm registered blind, so I can see colours and shapes in one eye, and the other eye is a false eye. So in the pool, it's fine because I can count strokes. I can kind of tell where the lane rope is, where other people are. It's all very predictable, one pool. And I'd seen people doing open water swimming, and I'd had to do it as part of a triathlon, but only a very, very short distance. And I thought, it'd be amazing, amazing to be able to swim outside because it's kind of swimming in a pool to me is like swimming running on a treadmill. So swimming outside has always been like my dream, and then eventually I managed to work out how I could do it, and then I've swam several different marathons and Lake Windermere twice, and then last week I swam the English Channel, which I always thought was impossible, but I managed to work out how I could do it, and it was an amazing swim, and that's me.
Melanie, we believe you're the first female to swim that English Channel without physical disability. So, congratulations.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about your very early life and your early swimming days. How did your blindness appear? Was it something you were born with? Was it an accident?
So I was born, my mum contracted toxoplasmosis when she was pregnant with me. So I was born with congenital toxoplasmosis, which I said has left me blind in this eye. This is a false eye. And this is I can see two over 60 out of it, which is basically colors and shapes. And it's been the same as that all my life. And I guess I've always really liked being in water because I like the feeling of it and the feeling supported by it and feeling all around me. And I'm very aware of the sensory experience of being in the water. So the movement of the water and the smell and taste and the feeling of it, and just being supported by it is just such an amazing experience, as we all know, I guess.
And were your parents nervous about your swimming, or were you one of these kids thrown in at age 3 and away you went?
I think, well, if my parents were nervous about it, they were very quietly nervous about it, and I wasn't really aware of it. My earliest memories of swimming is basically throwing myself into a swimming pool when my dad had turned his back. And apparently my mum was on the side watching it, horrified because my dad was with my baby brother. Didn't realize I was there, but I just threw myself in the water. I was never scared of it, so I think they probably were a bit concerned about it, but they kept it quiet. And they always encouraged me to try it and to swim, and they supported everything that I wanted to do. So as a parent now myself, I think they did an amazing job because it must have been scary, especially around the sea and open water, to try and let me go and enjoy things like that. But I think they made sure I learned to swim at an early age and were able to save myself if need be, so I think that probably helped a lot.
And when you're swimming in the pool, are you with a group of five-sided individuals that watch out for you? Do you try to get your own lane? How do you avoid slicing your hands on the barbed wire lane lines and crashing into the person who's actually swimming in the middle of the lane, not on their side?
Well, I've had various experiences over the years, many, 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 many experiences. I've swam in really, really busy lanes with many, many kids and adults, and I've had the privilege of swimming in a high performance centre where I've had the lane to myself, in a 50-metre pool, which is quite a lonely experience, actually. I think I'd rather be in a busy lane. I've swam with master swimmers, and clubs. Generally, swimmers tend to swim in a, an orderly fashion and keep their arms and legs to themselves. But recently, as part of my training over the last couple of years, I've done a lot of my training in the local pool, which is a university pool, and it can be really busy. And there are that's when I have to swim with the public, and we all know what it's like swimming with the public. You just don't know what you're going to get. Sometimes they'll stop if I catch them up and I can't see them, so I end up swimming into them and hitting their feet, which goes down well, as you know, it gets quite annoying, doesn't it? Sometimes they don't stop, and then they expect me to overtake, which obviously I can't do. I have jammed my fingers into the lane ropes far too many times. It's incredibly painful, isn't it? But I think I've learned, it's taught me patience and tolerance, and to just expect the unexpected, because you know it's a bit like when you're open water swimming, you can swim into a load of seaweed or a jellyfish or any kind of things that isn't very pleasant, and then you've got to deal with it, and things don't go to plan. So I could go to the pool with a set in my mind and turn up, and it's so busy that I can't do intervals because I can't see when people are coming and when I can go, and I just have to adjust my training plan. I think it is annoying, but it just teaches me a bit of tolerance. In a busy club situation, most people, when I swim with my master's club, most people are aware that I can't see them, and I think they get out of the way and they make allowances for the fact, especially when I'm doing backstroke, that I might come at them down the middle of the lane, because especially if we go, I don't think Americans do anti-clockwise and clockwise. It might just be a UK thing, but we alternate clockwise and anti-clockwise in a lane. If I go one way around, I just really struggle and I end up going down the middle of the lane, and yeah, that's when it can get a bit messy. But generally, it's good. Just have to expect the unexpected.
Do you remember the first long open water swim you did, say a mile, 1500 meters?
See, I went in straight at the deep end. Maybe I was thinking about this. I think the longest open water swim I did was, I mean, sorry, not the longest, the first was a 10 kilometer swim. I'd been introduced to open water swimming by a friend, in a local river, and I was just completely hooked. I loved it. I loved the feeling of being in the water and being in nature and being surrounded by all the smells and the wind and the just being immersed in nature. But I really wanted to actually swim. And I don't know why. I don't know what came over me, but I entered a 10K event, and I was wearing a wetsuit at the time, which, it makes it a little bit easier, but to go from swimming 400 meters was my main event, to go from that to swimming this 10 kilometers, I don't think I'd really thought it through, because I can remember I downloaded a training plan off the internet, and then I started to realize just what I'd signed up for. And now 10 kilometers isn't really anything. I could do that easily, but at the time it was a huge, huge thing. And I can remember my whole family came to watch me, my parents, or my family, and even the dog. We made a big weekend of it, and they all supported me and celebrated afterwards, and it was a huge thing. But I think it was really big for me because I had to try and work out how I was going to swim it. Not being able to see to sight, so you would sight on a buoy or something in the distance. It was in this really grim, dark lake in Wales where the weather was really windy, so the water was all choppy, and it was all grey, and the water was black, and the clouds were dark, and it was just all sort of miserable and cold. I'd kind of done this deal with my husband that he would kayak next to me. So he had this bright green kayak, which when I turned to breeze, if he was next to me, I could see. That was the only way that I could get around this lake, and I had to do 5 laps of this lake. And it was quite an interesting experience. I think I I struggled quite a lot because it was difficult to see him a lot. And he was getting blown about all over the place because it was a windy day. So he couldn't then talk to me because I couldn't hear him because he shouted and shouted. I still couldn't hear him because the water was rushing in my ears. And sometimes I couldn't see him. And it was looking back on it, I'm surprised I didn't find it more scary and intimidating, but I think I just kind of tried to relax and take it in my stride. And it, yeah, it was seemed a very, very long way. And I can remember just counting down the laps, and it was really quite hard work. And when I got out, somebody said to me, you know, that's well done and everything. And then he said, what's next? And in the back of my mind, I kind of thought, well, maybe the English Channel. But I never ever said it to anybody because I just thought that's just ridiculous. That's a stupid thing to say. How can you go from that to the English Channel without a
Well,
lot in between?
you must have patience because I can think of relationships that have fallen apart for similar experiences with kayakers and swimmers.
Oh, I didn't expect. Yeah, I didn't say that. Well, yeah, I thought it probably wasn't the place to say that. But yes, it was a very, very stressful. I can remember one time swimming into the back of it during that race, swimming into the back of the kayak, and I literally grabbed hold of the back of it and yanked it back and shouted at him. But I think we did other races after that. We swam the Thames Marathon, which is between Henley. Well, I swam the Thames Marathon. He kayaked. And it's between Henley out on Thames and Marlow, and it's 14 kilometres. And so again, I swam next to him with the kayak. And the organisers were really good because it's quite a busy race, but they said that's fine and they let him do that. We didn't have any communication device at the time, so it was relying just on me seeing him. And obviously it's more difficult with lots of people around. So he kept having to try and shout at me, but he'd try and talk, as we probably all have been in this situation, try and talk to me, but I couldn't hear him. And then he had to shout and shout until he got really loud. And then I thought he was yelling at me. So I'd stop and go, what? So we ended up having several warnings out about that. And then I managed to swim, attached myself to the back of somebody who had a very bright yellow tow float. And I was following along behind her. And he kept shouting at me to follow this yellow tow float lady. And I was going, I kept shouting, I'm trying, I'm trying. Really. So, yes, you're right. Having a kayaker that's your husband doesn't tend to go down that way. But and that's what made me think there must be a better way of doing this. There must be a way that he can communicate with me because I can't see his body language. I can't see that he's trying to talk to me. All I can see is this green blob. And he ends up getting very frustrated because he can't signal. He has to just shout and shout until I can hear him. So I kept thinking there must be a way of making this easier for both of us because he couldn't tell me when there was any obstacles. I mean, a kayaker in a normal event, you just follow them to get you to the right place. But for me, it's like a safety thing. So he has to get me around any obstacles that might be in the way. And tell me where I'm swimming to, basically. So it's not just the standard kayaker operation, really. So I did a lot of investigation, and then I came up with a radio system where he could talk to me. So he has like a radio device, and it transmits to a bone conducting headset that I wear, that he can then guide me, and tell me where there's any obstacles coming up or how far left I've got. That's another thing that I found very frustrating. When I can start my sprint finish as such, where I am in a race, how many people there are in front of me, or if I'm where everything is basically, and that's been a huge, huge help. So people can then they don't even have to be in a kayak. I've had people stand on the bank that guide me, and it's given me so much more confidence in my ability. So I can now swim properly, put my face in the water and actually swim with confidence, not worry about any obstacles that might be there. Because before then, I was obviously feeling a bit tentative and a bit unsure. So that's made a massive difference for both of us and our marriage as well. Because obviously, we don't have the arguments.
If you do want to be scared in the water, we'll invite you to come to Cork, Ireland at some point. We have a swim around the island on a very narrow river channel with everything from tree stumps to going over weirs both directions to a bridge that one time was submerged, so I had to swim underwater. to other bridges
Wow.
that are so low, you have to adjust your stroke to bridge pillars. There were no shopping carts in the way, so that was okay. But I can't imagine trying to do it on signals. Historically, James Pitar is an honoree of the International Marathon Swimming Hall of Fame. I had the pleasure of swimming with James once. His kayaker had a whistle, and it was, you know,
Yeah.
one tweet for left, two tweets for right. I don't know what it was when it was time to get the feed bottle. Maybe he just hit him in the head with it. I don't remember. But so technology has come a long way, and we certainly applaud the Channel Swimming Association for allowing you to use some new technology to kind of level out that the playing pitch. Do you remember the first time you had the pleasure of saying hello to a jellyfish in the open water?
Well, actually, it's not been that long ago. I know, having said that, I think it was on holiday. I think it was just after I got the headset. I was trying it out in the sea with my husband Richard was sat on a sunbed enjoying a pint of beer while I was swimming. He was on like a pier and I was swimming out and back. And I never saw it, and he never saw them. But every time I swam out and back, I got co just covered in like lots of little stings,
Yeah.
basically like stinging nettles all over me, and it came across my face and my arms and my legs. I never felt any kind of tendrils or anything like that. It was really, really odd. It wasn't what I was expecting it to be, and I didn't really know what it was. I had my suspicions, but I didn't know what it was. But it was only when it came across my lips and it really hurt that I actually got out then because I had enough. I can remember when I was swimming in Cornwall in the sea. I went once to the surface beach there. What's it called? Fitzroy Beach. So it's got a very narrow area that you can do anything other than surfing. And I went there. Had my wetsuit on again. This was when I first started swimming open water, and I got to the beach and this with Richard and this woman said, "Oh, you don't want to go in there. It's actually packed with jellyfish." And I thought, "Well, I've come to swim. I'm going to give it a go." So again, Richard stood on the side to give me directions. So I just went side to side, basically out past the breakers, and then swam backwards and forwards. And she wasn't joking. There were millions and millions of them, but they were the really kind of cute little ones that. They were tiny and they didn't sting, they just felt like little squidgy things. So they were fine, I didn't mind them. But I'd always been absolutely terrified of jellyfish. But that was one of my biggest worry was the channel because I can't see them in the sea. My biggest worry in the channel was there's going to be packed with jellyfish. So I just assumed that they're going to be there all the time. And I'd heard of lion's manes. I haven't had the pleasure of meeting a lion's mane yet. To be honest, I didn't get touched at all by it. Well, actually, I did, but it didn't sting me. And towards France, I got the barrels, which was a good sign because it meant I was coming up to the beach. Because somebody had told me if you encounter any barrels, they get quite big near France, and it indicates that you're getting near to the beach. So that I quite like that. And barrels didn't sting me anyway. So all in all, my journey with the jellyfish so far has been surprisingly good. Too good, I think. I've got one waiting for me, I think, somewhere.
So I'll help you with some of our definitions. The little stingy ones we call sea lice. There's a lot of discussion about what they actually are. Some people call them baby jellyfish. Somebody else has another description. They particularly get women with one-piece swimsuits because they get trapped and they absolutely eat the
Oh,
bellies.
yes.
So
Yeah.
our local
I've
ladies
got
go bikini at certain times of the year. The
good
squishy
plan.
ones we call moon jellyfish. And they typically don't sting. You can actually pick them up and throw them at people. Lion's manes are quite rare in the English Channel. They're quite common in the North Channel, which is one of the big challenges up there. And
Yes.
then I would say that the barrels are fine until they're bigger than you are. Then it can be quite intimidating.
I didn't get one like that, thank goodness.
And then finally, you will at some point if you continue in this sport, you will get one that gives you a sting that just stays with you for 5 minutes. And I remember swimming in Mallorca where I got stung simultaneously on both nipples. And I thought to myself, like,
Ooh.
did you guys practice this all year? I mean, what are your brothers say? So, like, you go left, I'll go right. And
Yeah.
it was this amazing sort of like the only two things I got going, it's just not possible to do that. Okay, so you talked to us about having this thought about the English Channel. Had it been a thought as a child, or was just after the 10K swim it kind of popped into your head?
I think I'd always known, well, obviously we'd always been aware of the English Channel and people swimming across it and the history of it. And it's such an iconic swim that it's all, I think it's always been there in my mind. And while I was swimming competitively, a friend of the family bought me Lynn Cox's book. And I read that, and I read about her swim across the was it the Arctic? Yeah, the Arctic, wasn't it? The
The
Bering Straits.
Bering Sea.
Yeah. And also her swimming across the channel and the Catalina Channel. And I thought it was just the most incredible thing. And I guess it's that must have sown the seed in the back of my mind. But again, I always just thought it was impossible because, I just couldn't, I could understand how I could swim in a pool, but you can't count your strokes all the way to France. And also, there's no lane ropes or anything out that can help you really. So I just thought it was just an impossibility. So I think I kind of parked it in the back of my mind. And it was only when I went, like I said, when I went to meet my friend who took me to the local river to try water swimming, and I experienced the thrill of being in the water and being in nature, that it kind of made me think, well, maybe these things could work. And then I did the 10K, and then like that sprung into my mind, and I only for a few seconds, and I parked it again because I thought that's just, it just, I couldn't do that. I mean, Richard couldn't kayak all the way across to France, that's for sure. Imagine the arguments we'd have then. It wouldn't be good, would it?
How did it go from a dream to a plan? What was the trigger? Who did you talk to? What spurred you to pick up the phone or send an email or?
I think it probably was my very good friend Heather Clatworthy. She's from Northern Ireland. She's done several channel relays, and she's attempted to swim the channel a couple of times. Had quite unfortunate reasons why she didn't get across. And I think it was her that really inspired me to think maybe I could do it and to sign up for it. And I'd like I've said I think I've said I really like a big challenge in my life. And there's not really, there wasn't one that bigger that I'd ever thought of before. So I thought I'd sign up for it. And you sign up so far in advance that you can forget about it for a little while, can't you, almost? And yeah, I think it probably was Heather. She's such an inspiring person anyway, that the things that she went through to do her swims, and she kind of encouraged me to sign up as well, because she thought, I've got such dogged bloody mindedness that I'd make a good channel swimmer.
And did you consult with your husband or did you inform him? Or does he know yet? A girls'
I
weekend
mentioned
is
it to
over
him, and
and
he
you
didn't
didn't
want.
tell him.
Yeah, we're a long week. Yeah, no, he knows. He didn't want me to do it initially because I think he was worried that if I didn't get across for whatever reason, that I'd find it really, really difficult to cope with, especially if it was conditions or something out of my control. So I think he began to accept it, and he realized how determined I was to do it. And then he's been really supportive. He wasn't on the boat. I didn't want him on the boat, but he has been very supportive. But when you go through something that's that intense, I don't think your spouse, if they're not involved, they can't really understand it, as much as you can try and tell them about it and show them videos and photos. Unless you're actually there, part of it, it's like a whole part of your life that they don't experience. It's really hard to kind of relay it to them and relate it to them, basically. I find that quite hard. I don't know how he feels about it, but it's like there's something, that's just a whole part of my life that he just doesn't know about.
And where did you land in France? And what was the sensation at the end? Did you slam into the rock? Did you feel the waves? Did you say hello to the barrel jellyfish? Did you touch the bottom at first? Well, bring us through the last minute or so.
Well, when I was imagining in all my training, when I was imagining landing in France, I was envisioning swimming into the shore and my feet touching the sand and like running up the beach and embracing everybody and meeting Patrice, and just having a great time on the beach. But as it turned out, I landed at the Cap, which is a very rocky place, no beach at all. I didn't know that because I couldn't see where I was going to end up. But I said to people, don't tell me how far away I am from France. I don't want to know. So they were relaying information to me at my feeds. And they were, they didn't, I said, I don't want to know how far away I am, how much time I've got left, or anything like that. So they didn't tell me. The first I knew that I was approaching France was my guide. They told me that I had to swim away from the boat, and the little dinghy will come round to meet me with one of my friends in, who was wearing a really bright neon orange top. And then I would tr have to try and swim next to her. So that's what happened. So I swam next to the little boat. That I can tell you, that is the best sentence that anybody has ever told me in my whole life, that the dinghy is coming round to you now. I can't, that just makes my oh, my heartbeat faster. I was so unbelievably relieved when I heard that. So I swam next to this little dinghy for a bit, and then when it couldn't get any closer, my friend got out into the water with me. She didn't touch me. She swam alongside me. She had a bright orange hat and a bright t-shirt on, so I could see her. And I said, it's at the beach. And she said, oh no, it's the rocks. And I've got to say, I wasn't very happy. I swore at her, because I really, really didn't want these rocks, because I'd heard that most people get hurt climbing out onto them. And I'm always scared of waves on rocks, because I just can't see to judge when to get out onto the rocks. But she swam me up to them, and I can remember very clearly putting my hands down onto these slippery, hard rocks. And they're not even either. I mean, for anybody who's been over there, they're all like higgledy-piggledy. There's not like a nice ledge and then another ledge. You have to try and find something to stand on to then get out onto the next one. And she did her best at trying to help me, but basically it was just me feeling with my hands. So I managed to clamber out onto these slimy, slippery rocks that weren't very flat. And I had these visions of, when I was imagining it, of standing up and waving my arms in the air in celebration. But basically, I just clambered out until my feet were out of the water. And then just in the photo, it looks like I'm doing a yoga pose. I've got both feet on one on the rock, one hand on the rock, and the other one in the air. So it wasn't really the finishing photo that I would like to have, but it was the end. And it was the most incredible feeling. I still can't believe it. It's just to achieve something like that that I just thought was impossible. It's just incredible, really. I can't really get my head around it. Not just the swim, but all the hurdles that I had to overcome to get to that point. It was just, yeah, it's just an amazing feeling.
So if we had whisked you away to a mountain in Tibet and called you a spiritual person, and I came up to you and I say, like, what are the lessons in life? What did you learn from the experience?
From just the channel or the whole build up to it.
The channel.
Well, it's interesting because my mum passed away last year, and I've really, really felt her with me in that swim. The conditions were absolutely perfect. I mean, the day before and ever since, it's been really windy and miserable. On that day, it was completely blue sky. The water was completely flat. The jellyfish just seemed to part for me. They didn't touch me, and the sea was warm, and everything was just perfect. And I really felt her there with me. And I don't know what I believe really about this kind of thing, but I just felt like she was there helping me and looking after me and cherishing me. So I do believe that, at times of need, upstairs crew can really help us out. I would never have thought that before, But so many things went perfectly that day that I can't really imagine anything else, any other reason.
So warm and calm and clear. Are you sure your husband didn't fly you down to the Aegean and get you a little bit confused?
Well, the photos look like it. Does not look like the English Channel at all. It looks like Lake Geneva.
Melanie, what's next for you in our sport?
I really don't want to do the Triple Crown because I don't want to swim the North Channel. It's got too many scary jellyfish in it and it's too cold.
You don't need the North Channel for the Triple Crown. You need Manhattan and Catalina.
That's the other Triple Crown, isn't it? See, there's the original Triple Crown that's isn't that the North Channel and the Bristol Channel?
Yeah,
Is that just yeah?
that's the
I'm not
original.
interested in that one. I think I want to do your one. I want to do the Round
Okay.
Manhattan and the Catalina Channel. I mean, ultimately, I would love to do Lake Geneva. I've swam that as a relay, and it was the most incredible experience. So I'd love to go back and do that as a solo, but that is huge. So that's going to take a little bit of working up to. But I would love. I think my next thing would be the 20 bridges because that does look amazing.
I breathe to the right, so I actually never saw Manhattan. So don't feel bad if you're down there and you don't get a great view of Manhattan, because I never saw it personally.
Ah,
I
and you've
went
gone the
anti-clockwise as they go, and never saw it.
other way
Melanie, thank you
around.
very much for your time today. What I'll tell everybody is, if you liked this interview, there's another 100 plus interviews on the Imshoff video channel. And a second, a screen will pop up to let you know how to subscribe to that, and also the rest of our communication vehicles. Melanie, thank you very much, and I look forward to hearing you after you've conquered Manhattan.
Thank you.